Hey, Gary. Look, we just heard Jasper can't go in. We're thinking you're up.
I'm out. What is up?
Congrats, Gary. You just got promoted to contract killer.
When I read that Texas Monthly piece about Gary Johnson, and I think a lot of other people, when they tried to make the story, tried to contain it to just that world of Gary Johnson in terms of his function within the police department. He was a fake hitman for the police department for decades. So there's endless amounts of stories to pull from.
How long have you been doing this?
That's none of your fucking business.
Yeah, it was during the pandemic I got a call from my buddy Glenn Powell. He says, have you heard, you know, this article, Hitman? I was like, I read that like 19 years ago or whenever. It's the same thing over and over, a solicitation, a setup, an arrest.
There was this one sentence when I read the Hitman article. It talked about this relationship that he had with this woman. She was actually in danger. She had an ex-husband who was trying to kill her. So she was trying to hire a hitman to kill her ex-husband before he could kill her.
You enjoying your pie?
All pie is good pie.
I told Rick, I said, I think that's the thread we need to pull.
I assume that's what we're here to talk about.
And Glenn was kind of bold. He was like, no, I think he just kind of gave me permission to start thinking like, okay, let's fictionalize some stuff here. We're not making a documentary about this guy.
This whole thing's got to be based on trust.
Yeah, man. No shit.
The chivalry was real. The identity was fake. And we thought, what a fun thing to explore. And so that's really where it started. That's where we started taking our creative license.
And so once we really got to talking, we started having fun with it. And somewhere along the way, we were just talking about it. I said, Glenn, we work well together. Let's just work on this script together.
Rick and I have been working together since I was like 14, 15 years old. We worked together for the first time on Fast Food Nation, had a great experience. And when we got to team up on Everybody Wants Them, I think Rick really saw me as a potential collaborator, because I think the way he works is he really leans into the people that he's on set with.
Just so happy this is how it's all going for you.
Thank you.
Once we had this incredible ensemble and put all of their brains on it, it became kind of this new organism. And that's really what makes Rick, I think, singular director, is he really looks at filmmaking as a team sport. He brings everybody in there, and I think it sings because of it.
Are you gonna introduce me to your friend?
What I love about both Rick and Glenn, the first thing they both told me were like, we want your take on it, and we want you to kind of mold Madison to you. And I had never had that opportunity to have so much to say in my character.
For the record, I love people.
And yet you killed them.
There was no ego when bouncing off ideas. A lot of the sex scenes weren't in the script. And when they were talking about, oh, maybe we do like a little montage of this, a montage of that, the Puerto Rican in me came out. I was like, let's make this movie fucking sexy. Can we make this sexy? I'm like, I got this part. Just leave this one to me.
Please unbuckle your seatbelt. It's for your own safety.
Yeah, one of the most fun things was when we realized the real Gary Johnson did alter his looks, customizing his look to the solicitor. We just really went to town on that. Probably went a little overboard.
Like Miami Vice.
Yeah.
There's a complicated individual here who's sort of having the most controlled version of an existential crisis. When people do go through a midlife crisis, it's what we all do. We try on different clothes and we try on different wardrobes. And what Gary Johnson is able to do is he does that for his work.
You're young. You'll be making yourself an orphan.
That's the point.
The people you're dealing with are so out there to begin with, to believe what they believe, and they're so kind of desperate. They've suspended rationality so completely at the point they're doing what they're doing that Gary can in fact dress up this way and it's believable.
I don't need your reasons or your fucking business plan. Give me the name and the money.
I straight the business.
I'm kind of proud to have made a New Orleans movie that's kind of a suburban New Orleans movie. He lives out of town a little bit in a boring little house that doesn't look like New Orleans at all. But that was kind of Gary's life. We're making a comment on that. There's an underbelly there and a volatility that we were hoping to capture too that I think comes through.
We're about to go into the deep end of the pool here.
Rick and I really just locked arms at every step of the way and talked out every beat of this. And it's so cool to watch it now and watch how small moments that we talked about on set or sat at a laptop and we're like, I think this is how it worked. Then you see, you're like, oh my God, thank God we made that decision together, you know, because it could have gone off the rails. I think this is a really delicate movie. So it was a series of fortunate events that I think led us to a movie that I'm really proud of.
I'm personally excited to hear what people think about it. I just hope people have fun with it and not try to pinpoint exactly what it is.
Only a director like Rick can pull off something that is this delicate, and I think he nailed it. And I think only because he's had this many decades of playing in every sandbox in every genre could he pull something like this off. Because it is an identity crisis for another director. This would be crazy for anybody else to tackle.
Okay, Daniel Day.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Who was that guy in there?
I don't know.
I'm a fake hitman.
Madison.
その依頼人との出会いが人生を狂わせる。
He let go.
She went here, Gary?
The hitman.
彼の見つけた自分の本当に生きるべき姿とは。
We'll see.
Hitman.